Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Brahmanandam Param Sukhadam Kevalam Jnanamurtim Dvandvatitam Gagana-sadrisham Tattvamasyadilakshyam Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadhi Sakshibhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami Om. Adorations to Sadguru, who is Brahman, the giver of supreme bliss, embodiment of pure consciousness, one without a second, vast as the ether, infinite, eternal, beyond the three gunas and their modifications, the supreme preceptor. Yoga Vasistha Nirvana Prakarana Purvārdha, Section 53, Arjuna Upakhyan, Lord Krishna's teachings continue. Sage Vasistha gave essence of the Gita teachings to Rama. This is a reference, storyline. And I have already explained that all teachings are relating to the same Brahman. Brahman doesn't age, he doesn't change. Brahman is the truth. Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti. So all the scriptures, Upanishads, Mahabharata, Ramayana, they're known as itihasas, Vedas, Brahma Sutras, all focus on bondage and release. Bondage and release, both terms are in the realm of Maya. And Maya is non-existent. Maya is Brahman. So keeping that in view, we continue with the teachings. Sage Vasistha is relating to Rama the wisdom that Krishna imparted to Arjuna. And here is Krishna's statement from the Gita. Every action is performed due to the conjunction of many factors. For the ego to take the credit for performing an action is an expression of gross ignorance. An enlightened intellect frees the ego of its erroneous arrogation. I am the doer. This relates to in the Gita, in 18th chapter, verse 14, Krishna says to Arjuna, Adhisthanam tatha karta karanam cha prithag vidham vividhascha prithag cheshta daivam chaivatra panchakam. What does that mean? There are five factors inherent in the performance of any karma. Five. Keep the five fingers before you. This is the view of Sankhya, that's a term used in the Gita, same as Vedanta. These five factors are, first we call Adhisthanam. Adhisthanam is, think of the simile of a farmer that has the project of harvesting a produce. What are the things needed for the farmer? He needs a farm. So all that is needed for soul's evolution, all that set is adhisthan. Karta, next term. Jiva is the farmer. The soul is the one that does the farming work, harvesting the fruits of karmas. Karanam, but for a farmer to harvest, first he has to start all the sowing project. And that requires a lot of instruments to be used to work upon the farm. What are those instruments? They are called karana. They are the indriyas, senses of perception, organs of action. And if you have all that, if the farmer has the field and he has all the instruments, he has to have vitality to work. That vitality is called chesta, functions of the vital forces. He has to exercise his muscles, his hands, his feet. But behind that, pranas. And if you have all this, the farmer has all setting, everything perfect. But weather forecast. It's going to be a big wind. So that factor is called daivam. Ordinarily translated as destiny. So, for any project that you have before you, project can be two types. Positive, nyayam ya viparitam va. Nyayam means that which is at the right track. Right track project leading the soul to liberation, moksha. Wrong track project leading the soul to the cycle of birth and death. But whatever is your movement, you are moving in a positive way or in a negative way. These five factors are always involved. So don't pat your ego for accomplishing the project. Because all these five are responsible. Ego is not the only one. So if you give all the credit to the ego, then you are endowed with durmati, wrong understanding. If you give credit to God and turn your life to upasana, now you are endowed with sumati, because behind all these factors, Brahman is the source and Brahman is God. So Godward movement is the important lesson from this instruction. Yogis perform actions for the sake of purifying the heart. That's the difference between durmati and sumati. One who is endowed with sumati or sanamati, good understanding, he performs this whole project. Action here implies movement of your whole personality that has four aspects: karma, action, emotion, will and reason. Karma yoga, bhakti yoga, dhyana yoga, jnana yoga. When all these yogas begin to blend in a melodious manner in your daily life, then the type of understanding that allows you to do that is called sanamati, sumati, good understanding. And that's the biggest blessings given by sages. Sabko sanmati de bhagwan. May God give sanmati to all. Because then all your farming process is focused on purifying the chitta and thereby to have the revelation, Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. Kumati, on the other hand, ends up with inflating the ego and creating bondage of karma. Directing your mind to God, O Arjuna, perform your actions devoid of attachment. Attachment is asakti. Any layer of attachment, any type of asakti, means your involvement in giving credit to your ego and developing egoism. So whatever promotes egoism in a broad sense is the path of attachment. Attachment is raga. It automatically includes dvesha. When you like something, there are many things you have to dislike. When you dislike, then again you have to like something. The like and dislike, these are two fingers of asakti. That which makes asakti more profoundly meaning clinging, clinging to worldly values. Your ego is an infinitesimal part of your essential self. Essential self is the sun. Ego is an illusion created by ignorance. You are a reflected sun in a jar of water. Reflected sun is not the real sun. But there develops an illusory sense of identity. And that's the ego. Each reflected sun develops the illusion that I am in such a wonderful part. With capacity of doing amazing things, doing wondrous experience, and moving from pot to pot. So that I am is insignificant ego compared to the sun. The reflected sun is insignificant. Repeatedly renounce the sankalpas or thoughts or the objects of the world as they arise in your mind. Be vigilant. Watch over your mind. If you are very sensitive, there is subtle recognition created by your own conscience that here you are stepping out of order. And that enables you to understand your error and therefore you correct it. Therefore, having errors in itself is nothing wrong. But along with your errors, there develops a movement for correcting the error. Then we say the mind is alert. So you begin to recognize the difference between kusankalpa and susankalpa. Kusankalpa, wrong type of will. Suddenly your mind develops, this is what I have to do. lot of trouble in the world. Let me open the refrigerator. Start eating waffles. It's a kusankalpa. Susankalpa. Let's pray, meditate. Let's do our duty, wait and watch. This is the divine plan. And God is the upadrashta, He is the overseer. And source of all your energies in God. If your mind begins to develop that, the sankalpa, to turn to God, to enjoy a sense of relaxation by surrendering yourself to God, then that movement is called susankalpa, right type of sankalpa. And that, how much susankalpa can you have, that will depend upon the degree of your asanga, detachment. If you are too gripped by your temptation, your sankalpa will not be firm. Develop the art of surrendering yourself to God. Surrendering to God, easily said in words, but it is a profound process. It requires a total change in your personality, in increasing integration. But that doesn't mean that you don't start. In starting stage, you are always in a kindergarten level. But you have to go into kindergarten in order to grow up. So whatever helps you to begin with is perfectly okay. But you must develop a deeper level of surrender. And the more surrender you experience, greater is your ability to face your challenges in a joyous manner. For a hero, challenging situations are occasions for adventure. A mountain climber, having climbed small mountains, now he has a challenge to climb a bigger mountain. So when he sees a bigger mountain, he doesn't sink down with dejection, but he is happy. So try to figure that out. It's how challenging situations in life are viewed by Kumati in a wrong way. Sumati, with God within, sustained by God, supported by Him, this is nothing. All that you have to do, wait and watch. Be busy, do the right thing. Continue your sadhana, do your integral yoga in life, but with inner patience and relaxed heart. And you will be surprised. Wait, watch, and wonder. Three W's are waiting for you. It is divine will that sustains and prompts all the activities of the world. By resigning to divine will, you will become free of the bondage of karmas. That's same thing, surrender to God, and thereby increasing bhakti, devotion, leading to para bhakti. God alone is the object of infinite love, goal of your life. It is divine will that sustains and prompts all the activities of the world. By resigning to divine will, you will become free of the bondage of karmas. O Arjuna, I am the reality behind this universe. I am a space with all its directions. I am like the akasha. I am the sustenance of all actions. I am the time spirit. I am duality and non-duality. I am also beyond duality and non-duality. For all these, non-duality, duality, etc., they are concepts of the mind. They are vrittis of the thought waves. You are being pointed to two-aspected reality in your personality. One is apparent reality. One is the reality. The reality is like the screen. Apparent reality is mental projections on the screen. The projections on the screen, that's what creates a dream-like world process. The ordinary dream is called short dream. All your daily experiences is called a long dream. But the predicament of person is the same. In dream, three things are out of your sight. Subject is erroneous. The dream subject is not real subject. Dream world is not real. Experiences are not real. So, the point is, try to understand the world you are experiencing based on mental projections. The entire world process is illusory. The entire cinema show is glorifying the screen. You have not seen anything other than the screen. But it is the screen that becomes a terrifying figure of yours in the projection world and makes you scream. What's making you scream? Screen. Put it another way, see the difference between pure consciousness and relative consciousness. Pure consciousness is ever present in your personality. Awareness, absolute awareness. But awareness of transient experiences, they are reflections caused by mental projections. And this type of awareness is called bhava pratyaya, the awareness relating to mental projections or created by mental projections, where you experience gain and loss, pleasure and pain. All these are called bhava movement. The world process becomes real. But underlying all this is pure, absolute consciousness. In daily life, there is little reflection of this reality. Each time you go to deep, deep sleep, all the world experience moves away from you. All the cinema show stops for a while. And you are not a loser. You love your body so much in deep sleep. Where is your body? And all your wonderful, interesting details of life all move away from you, and you are perfectly at rest. In deep meditation, you come to the same experience in a positive way. When all this moves away and you find you are not the body, you are not the mind, an amazing thrill enters your heart, a source of great inspiration. And that shows that you can become deeply rooted in that awareness. I am Prajnanam Brahma, pure consciousness, ever unaffected by all the dream-like experiences. I am the sky, sky-like, pure awareness. All experiences that are relative consciousness, they drift like clouds, creating countless dramas. But I am ever the same. Arjuna asked, O God of gods, what form of thine should I meditate upon? What attributes of thine should I meditate upon for attaining perfection in life? Lord Krishna replied, O sinless Arjuna, I have two forms, one suited for meditation by aspirants, and another that is beyond the reach of the mind, senses, and the intellect. One form of mind is with attributes, another is beyond all attributes. Try to understand. Firstly, the two aspects of upasana, meditation on Saguna Brahman and meditation on Nirguna Brahman. Sagun and Nirgun. But Sagun comes again in two stages. Sagun Sakar, Sagun Nirakar. Total become three aspects of upasana. We begin with Sagun Sakar, first initiated into a mantra that suits your mind. Having adopted the mantra of any Ishta Devata, Shiva, Rama, Krishna, Devi, whomsoever. Now, each time you meditate, you bring the entire figure of that deity. If it's Lord Vishnu, Narayana, four arms, Shankha Chakra Gada Padam, in his hands, mace, kanch, lotus, discus. So you go on reflecting upon all the details of the form, and that captures your mind in a profound way. But as you advance, form is transcended. The attributes of God, they dominate your mind. Instead of Shankh, Chakra, Gada, Padam, they are the forms. Let me keep the order in another way. Mace in the hand of God. How does it look? But what is the reality behind the mace? What the mace suggests? It suggests practice of dhyana, hammering upon your mind again and again. When you do any affirmation, you put within your mind, I am not the body, But one hammer didn't do well. So, the dhyana movement is the mace movement. Kancha movement is dhyana movement. Kancha awakens. Dhyana awakens. If you are constantly led by your ego, you are sleeping, dreaming. Wake up. Ego is not all of you. Ego is just an illusion. It's a big cancer. And lotus in the hand of God relates to bhakti yoga, path of devotion. And discuss the chakra relates to karma, because it is in the realm of karma that we look for God's grace. Karma becomes accelerated by grace. And it is in the realm of karma that you wait and watch for terrible situations to pass over. And they do pass over. Just like in the storyline, each time there is a terrifying situation for a devotee, Lord Vishnu discharges his chakra, and chakra clears up the path, makes a miracle. So miracle you experience in your daily life while facing the challenges in the world. So when you are seeing Lord Narayana in this aspect of dhyana, jnana, bhakti and karma in your daily life, you are practicing saguna nirakar. But saguna sakar is not left out. You continue to hold on saguna sakar. But that does not become your confining. It's just like you continue to hold on to your house, your home. But it doesn't stop you from roaming around. Rather, it gives you more possibility to explore, move ahead, progress. And then, when yoga is perfected, integral yoga comes to perfection, then you discover aham brahmas. Then what happened to the kanch? What happened to the lotus? What happened to all the other details? There is nothing but Brahman, the absolute. Nirgun nirakar. So it's very important to understand the role of upasana in your life. Therefore, O Arjuna, be devoted to my relative form as long as your intellect does not bloom into intuition. For nirgun nirakar, your intellect has to become intuitive. So until then, hold on to saguna sakar as well as saguna nirakar. When you attain enlightenment, you will realize me as the formless, transcendental I am. I am, that am I. Meditation on different forms of the Divine Self is an effective method of purifying the citta. Now, meditation on different forms means affirmations, sitting quiet, still, and using Vedantic statements, mano buddhi cittani naham, am neither the mind nor buddhi, nor chitta nor egoism. I am pure, enlightened. I'm rushing these words, and you may use them in a rush as well. But don't forget about enjoying the rasa from the rush. Even if you are doing it in the beginning, using palabras, and when you do palabras, you go on bringing so many words in your mind. But that becomes a basis to step a little higher and hold on to a certain statement that opens your heart to a feeling of expansion, a feeling of stillness, of delight. Remember, life becomes more and more blessed with shakti, bhakti and mukti. Blessed with strength. And strength of faith allows the bhakti, devotion to blossom. And this process leads you to mukti, liberation. In other words, we also use three terms, sahaj, saras, sanidhya. If you have a strength, problems you face, they become an opportunity of adventure. They become sahaj, easy to handle. And your life's movement becomes saras. Great transformations occur in your personality. But it's a delightful movement. Remember, for a child to grow up, his entire body has to go through a terrible challenge. And yet, child doesn't complain. You never hear, "No, mummy, I'm having growing pain." So, in spite of all your challenging circumstances, led by your inner faith and purity of heart, you come to a state of not complaining against any challenges, rather waiting with a spiritual expectation to see how it is resolved by God's grace. You know it is going to be resolved. But until then, you wait and watch. And that makes life interesting. Life's a drama. And drama must bring suspense. When the chitta or the heart is purified, a devotee begins to behold the Divine Self underlying every name and form in this world. The ultimate goal, Brahman alone exists, Aham Brahmasmi. When the mind is purified, a devotee adopts the attitude, all this is Brahman. He thus worships Brahman at all times. His mind continues to flow to Brahman in every situation. Though living in the world, he is ever free of the world process. And that's the state of sthita prajna. And with this, I will conclude for today. Om Ram 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 Om Om Namah Shivaya Om Namah Shivaya Om Namah Shivaya Om prayer for shower of karuna, mercy, grace of God over all of you. May you be blessed with shakti, bhakti and mukti and turn your life sahaj, saras, leading to sanidhya, leading to unity with God. Om Trayambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushti Vardhanam Urvarukum Vabandhanan Mrityor Mukshyama Amritat Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina Sarve Santu Niramaya Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kashchid Dukh Bhag Bhavet Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat.